So this panel was brought together to celebrate the launch of Pénélope Bagieu's book, California Dreaming, which is about the life of Mama Cass, who was an unconventional celebrity who defied conventions about what it meant to be a star. So the co-panelists are rising stars themselves in comics and are all going to speak about their work and how they make choices as cartoonists and how they present their characters. First, we have Pénélope Bagieu, who was born in Paris to Corsican and Basque parents. She's a best-selling graphic novelist, and her editorial illustrations have appeared all over the French media, including regular portraits of inspiring women for Le Monde. She also drums in a rock band. Exquisite Corpse was her first graphic novel, and her new graphic novel, as I mentioned, California Dreamin', was published on International Women's Day. Katie Skelly, Katie, do you want to raise your hand since it's not in order? Is a New York City-based cartoonist. But first, let me show you. These are all of their books. And then there's California Dreamin'. So Katie is a New York City-based cartoonist whose comics include Nurse Nurse, Operation Margarine, and newly My Pretty Vampire, which will be out this summer in the Agent webcomic series. She writes and lectures about comics and has a podcast called Trash Twins with Sarah Horrocks. Whit Taylor is a cartoonist who has contributed to The Nib and recently The Illustrated Pen, where I have to say I was very pleased to get to edit her, among other online and elsewhere. Her book Ghost Stories will be out from Rosarium Press in the fall. She's also a health educator. Julia Gfrörer is an American cartoonist living in New York. She's the author and illustrator of Black is the Color and most recently Laid Waste for Fantagraphic Books. And Natalie Andrewson is an illustrator and cartoonist from North Carolina. She also lives in New York and Brooklyn. She's worked on lots of book projects, covers, magazines, newspaper illustrations, and animations. She's been published by Piau, is that Piau? Piau Studio with her comic Lemon and Cat, and is currently working on a graphic novel adaptation of the original Nutcracker story for First Second. And that will be coming out in 2019. So I want to start talking to Pénélope about California Dreamin'. So I'll show some of the work, but my main question is, what first attracted you to the story of Cass Elliot?
It wasn't necessarily the fact that she was Cass Elliot that really intrigued me, but more the fact that she clearly doesn't look like a rock star from the 60s, where clearly she was not just bigger than what rock stars usually look like, but also she hated folk music and she was in a folk band. And she wanted to be a rock star, but she grew up in a family that ran deli in Baltimore. And clearly she was destined to inherit the delis. And just she said, I don't want to make pastrami sandwiches all my life. So when she was 19, she just left on her own for New York City, which was pretty cool. And everything went not as it was planned. So I like the fact that even though everything was against her, she knew what she wanted to do and she always found a plan B. And I'm always interested in plan B people. So
how did you create the look of Cass? She's vibrant on the page. What did you do both in how you drew the book and what kind of reference material did you use?
As usual, I use people I know who never recognize themselves. But I had a very good look at what she really looked like so that she doesn't look totally different. But then I tried to forget what I saw and tried to create my own cast that was clearly not like the actual one, but that would be more human to me, like a doll I could really play with and do whatever I want with. So I needed her to be able to express all the emotions I needed her to express.
Tell me about the drawing of the book. Now this is done in pencil, is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So did you do pencils and then ink typically, or how did you approach the process of it?
For this one, no, there's no ink. It's just regular pencils. And I used maybe 30 pencils because it's a very long book. So I kept the tiny bits that I had sharpened to this big, and I still have them all, very tiny pencils. So no, it's just regular pencils and hairspray to fix it afterwards. So also the original drawings really smell like the hair salon. It's awful because if you want to buy the actual thing to fix pencil, it costs a fortune. So I use hairspray and the cheapest hairspray. So it's pencil and hairspray. And usually I work only on Photoshop. So it was kind of a first thing for me, but it was I needed to have a challenge in the way I drew this book so that I wouldn't get bored because it was a very long book again, and also I was working between Paris and New York, so I really needed to be
concise,
my movements, and not too heavy, and I wanted to be able to draw from cafe and friends' gardens and things like that. So when I found friends with gardens. And so, and also that's the reason why there are lots of little fingerprints and stains that I decided to leave in the end. So it almost looked like a good sketchbook. But
I love the way that the pencils give her this freedom and sense of spontaneity on the page. Which gets to the characterization of Cass. So you and I spoke actually the other day. I had the opportunity to interview Penelope for a longer piece that we'll be publishing in the Paris Review. And you told me then that in as much as you looked at historical material, you also really looked at contemporary icons in the fat empowerment movement like Beth Ditto. Can you speak to that? What did you want readers to take away? And in looking at the historical record, what did you use and what did you leave behind in terms of the visual references?
Well, when we spoke, we mentioned the clothing aspect, because it is true that when you look back to the footage of their shows or pictures of her, she was always hiding in clothes that more looked like tents than actual dresses. Although she's said to be very coquette and also very careful about her appearance, so that was kind of odd. But I think it is still very hard to be a public person when you're overweight today, but I think it was even worse in the 60s where, well, they're almost invisible. So I really wanted, because to me it was more coherent with the kind of woman I wanted to create, that she's definitely not the kind of woman who will hide under a tent. So I wanted her to have. And also she was said to be very, very flirty and very charming all the time. So I thought it kind of made sense that she would be in, you know, cute dresses.
Are there other people today you looked at that you can name?
Not that I can name.
All right, we'll move on and give Julia a chance to talk about. Oh, sorry. I'm sorry, Katie. You guys are perfectly switched. So Katie's new book is My Pretty Vampire. And like her two previous books, she has this bold pop style. So your work is clearly influenced by a range of sources, French cinema, 60s and 70s exploitation films, pulp comics. I wanted to ask, what's your current obsession? Where does the pretty vampire come from?
Well, to be totally honest, my current obsession is The Real Housewives of New York, so that doesn't totally pertain to this. But prior to that, when I was working on My Pretty Vampire, the obsession was the French director Jean Rollin, who did a series of erotic vampire films in the late 60s, early 70s, up through the 90s until he passed away. He was really obsessed with just looking at female sensuality in a sort of like soft pornographic way. And, you know, I'm a big horror fan, but I'd never seen anything quite like those films because they're not, they don't take you on the same path you think you might go down when you're watching a female vampire film. Obviously, there, you know, are some softcore elements to them, but they also have these really beautiful poetic moments to them as well. And so that's what I was looking at. Also looking at a lot of like Italian horror, looking at, you know, Dario Argento and looking at Giallo films. Stuff like that, and trying to really like kind of steal those color palettes and apply them to the work that I was doing, because my last two books have been in black and white. So really wanting to take that palette and sort of be overwhelming and sort of tell you know, a story about a woman with a palette that was going to be something that you couldn't look away from. So I wanted to sort of draw you into the horror with that kind of color style.
This isn't from My Pretty Vampire, though, this page.
No,
right?
It's not. I wish it was. This is from, for the past few years, I was doing a series for the website sluttist.com, which was, they commissioned me to do these, again, soft pornographic comics for them. And so I decided, you know, it was around the time that Milo Manara was getting into all this trouble with his Spider-Woman cover. Mm-hmm. And I decided, what if I decided to sexualize Spider-Man? And so I drew him into a pornographic comic.
I like his head is just casually getting. So I wanted to ask you about color.
Yeah.
Can you speak more about how you use it in this book? This is your first full color book,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Well, I think I really just wanted to borrow from the palettes in cinema that I've always really enjoyed. And I also really wanted to borrow from comics from the 60s and 70s from Europe that I really liked, like Guy Pellart or, you know, Guido Crepac, stuff like that. So, yeah, I wanted it to look like something out of time, like a little bit out of step from, because I feel like the way that things are colored now, there's a lot of pastel, there's a lot of gradient, there's a lot of like risograph type of influenced color. And so I wanted to do something that was totally, you know, anachronistic from that, but I also didn't want to do something in bad faith and try to make it look like a comic from that time. Mm-hmm. So that's why I went with the digital color to sort of show like this is from now, but it's influenced by things from the past.
It's used also as a plot element. It seems that she changes color at key moments.
Yeah,
in the story.
Well, that came from I'm a very big fan of the 1973 Japanese film Belladonna of Sadness, and the main character in that, you know, whenever she goes through a character transformation, her hair changes color. And I think in the same way that, you know, like I change my hair color all the time, like whenever I'm going through changes in my life, that's like my key mode of expression. So I wanted to have a character that could kind of flow and like take on different costume elements and hair and makeup elements and stuff like that, because I do think that that's, you know, an important part of self-expression. So I wanted to give that to the character.
So rereading your work, particularly looking at Nurse Nurse, which is your first book, your characters could be called doll-like or idealized figures, but then they go on to do very bad things. That's typically what happens. Can you speak about that dissonance? And I also wondered, are you surprised by how the books turn out? Do you know when you start drawing what these characters will get into?
Well, I always feel a big disconnect from anything that I do, and it's not really until like 6 months to a year later that I recognize like, oh, this was something that came from my mind and my hand and my body ultimately, and you know, a year and a half or however long of working and like suffering. But yeah, I think having characters all sort of conform to the same body type comes out of, again, my love of the 60s comics and looking at, again, Crepax, or looking at something like Jean-Claude Florist's Barbarella, where, you know, it was sort of like a prototypical babe comic where she gets to go on these journeys and do all these different things in the universe, but she, weirdly enough, kind of learns agency through all of that. Like Barbarella becomes like a mother in the series. Like you wouldn't expect that, you know? So I find that sort of disconnect between like something that you'd want to project a lot of ideas onto, like this babe, and she goes through a journey that, you know, she ends up like a fully fledged person and she can still be sexual. I find that sort of journey really interesting, because I do think a lot of times women, you know, characters or in real life, they're not allowed to have that sort of sexual nature. So it does always kind of surprise me. It surprises me when I'm working at how dark I can get.
Right.
Because I never quite set out to get there, but I think just when you're spending that much time alone, you know, cartooning is very lonely, you get to those places, and I'm always glad that I do in the end.
Yeah, I wrote down that they're more about destruction than seduction.
I think that's true. I think that's fair. I think, I don't know. Well, I also think the destructive process is a creative process. Mm-hmm. So, you know, even me, like personally, as I've gone through life and had things happen to me that have destroyed me, they've ultimately built me back up. So mm-hmm. I want to put those in the characters that I do.
So we're going to move on. I'm just showing quickly some more of these beautiful pages to Whit Taylor's work. And Whit, this is the cover of your book, Ghost. And this is the micropress edition. And then a new edition with other stories will be coming out from Rosarium. And I'm going to mention all of the books from these creators will be available for sale after the talk and for a signing. And Whit and Natalie in particular have micropress editions that were rarely available, so you should get in line for those. So Whit, you blend autobiographical and fantastical elements in much of your work. I wanted to ask you, what does it mean to draw yourself again and again in these pages?
I mean, it's changed over the years. I think that my purpose for doing like journal comics and autobio years ago is maybe a little bit different than it is right now. So there's part of me that's like kind of over drawing myself, but it's fun to see like what direction it takes. It used to be a lot more about like day-to-day concerns, just kind of to blow off steam more so, and then it became more of an exercise in like trying to actually get good at telling stories about my own life. And because I don't think that, you know, I think there's often this perception that it's a easy entry point into comics, and just because you make autobio doesn't mean it's necessarily good. I think there's certain like things that come over time with like learning how to really figure out what in essence are you trying to say, mm-hmm. And why is it worth telling, and why should people care? And so those are the things I'm always trying to like come back to.
This page here, and I think several of the pages you sent are about feeling out of place. Is that from Ghost? No, it's it makes
This was kind
version.
Of like a precursor to Ghost, actually. That's why I included it. Yeah.
About feeling caught and captured after an assault. So they're therapeutic in a way. And I wanted to ask you about that process of drawing as therapy. Is that part of what you found through doing autobiographical comics?
Sure, and I think it's two part. So with Ghost is like, there's a fantastical element about like meeting these dead historical figures, and it kind of leads into the main character, AKA myself, dealing with this like sexual assault. And that's a very brief, shortened version, but it was therapeutic in the sense that like I was able to, I guess, put on the page something that I couldn't like express, mm-hmm. maybe verbally or even just like emotionally to myself. But I think on the opposite end is it like it helped. I saw like the effect it had on other people who read it and mm-hmm. like the survivors who contacted me after reading mm-hmm. it, and that was like a kind of another therapy in and of itself, I guess. So.
You've just recently got into more political reporting as well.
Yeah.
What is this page from? Is this also from the precursor?
This was something else. This was, a hybrid autobio fiction mm-hmm. piece that I included because it kind of tied into some of the stuff I've been exploring around race. So that's
right.
Why I put it in there.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to lead into in talking about your reporting, because sure. You've taken work you've done on themes discussing issues of race in your autobio mm-hmm. comics and now taken them to political reporting. You had a widely disseminated piece just a week or two ago on the NIB called What is Race? Is that correct?
Yep.
The title? Can you talk about what the response has been like to that work? And
yeah, sure. So to be honest, there's part of me that's so sick of writing about race. Like I've been doing it for a while and I'm kind of like, all right. But like, I think that there's so many things you can explore with it. And it's the NIB, for instance, is a way that I can, it's a platform that I can use to discuss subjects to a greater audience. And mm-hmm. so I feel really like fortunate that I've had that opportunity. And so like this one here is like a piece I did on natural hair. So I've always, you know, been interested in my identity as a person who's Black or mixed race. And I've used it to talk about that. And I've used it to talk about more like cultural, sociological, social science issues mm-hmm. around those things. So I did this piece called What is Race that kind of explored kind of the history of how we have come to have these current racial designations and why, if we actually look at the biology, it doesn't really make much sense. And the response was pretty good. I mean, it was really good. I had a lot of people who had positive things to say. I also had Charles Murray, who wrote The Bell Curve, get annoyed about it. So I consider that a success, you know? So that's really, you know, what I've been meaning to do is just have a greater discussion about these things through comics.
You're also a health educator, and I wanted to ask, does that inform your comics? Because you are working in this space that's taking autobio and fiction to educate, often about issues that are regarding women's health.
Yeah, so in some of my day job work, I've done stuff with reproductive health counseling, where you're talking to people who might not have an understanding of basic health literacy, for instance, and you want to be able to take concepts and break it down so that it's something that can be understood. And often visuals help, that's just something that, we know helps. And also just being able to communicate things clearly. So I think comics are one of the best mediums for being able to communicate ideas clearly. So I definitely think it's a value that I've had throughout my life, and it's just manifested itself in two different places.
Mm-hmm. So now we're moving to Julia's work. This is Laid Waste, which takes place in this devastated landscape. My original question was, what drew you to think about the plagues? But I did want to ask what the inspiration was behind Laid Waste. And the images, we aren't going to read them through, but this is, I'm just going to show the audience this sequence, which is a mother and her child is taken by death. She has a conversation with death. And then she goes and digs the baby back up.
You want to know where that came from?
I think I'm curious about what the inspiration was behind the context of this book, because you create a world and then explore relationships within it. So what drew you to this?
I'm really interested in personifications of death, the whole kind of dance macabre, or the death and the maiden. There's a long tradition of artwork that shows death as a figure that is not exactly negative, but maybe seductive, or else sort of workmanlike. Like the concept of the Grim Reaper, for example, is the idea is that death isn't a gentleman; he's a laborer who is indiscriminately doing his work of cutting down the crops. And I read a poem, I think it was an old German poem, probably medieval, that had content very similar to this, that of a woman trying to convince death not to take her child. And that poem said something that I used in the book, which is, she says, this child can't even walk, how should she dance with you? And so this is the main character's mother. The baby later becomes, her name is Agnes, she becomes the main character of the book. And her mother is put to sleep here by Death's half-brother Sleep. And she wakes up and she says, where's the baby? They say they've already buried her. So she goes to the graveyard, she finds this fresh grave, and she digs up the baby who is still alive. That is based on a dream that I had about my son, where he was in the trash or something, and people thought that he had died, and then I dug him up and he was still alive. And it was really a very frightening dream.
Your work is all about bodies. I think this is, when we talked about this, when we talked about the theme of this panel being about representation of bodies, mm-hmm. I love that you were on the panel and we had, because your work is about bodies that are dead and alive and dying. Uh-huh. And there's, in both of your books, this intensity of sort of women coming to have erotic experiences in extreme circumstances. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to ask you something that I actually saw you tweet about on Twitter, where when you were drawing this book.
I'm always running my mouth on Twitter. I don't know if it's something I'm going to want to cop to.
I don't know if the first part of my statement refers exactly to the second one, but it's a question I had. You wrote something like, it's really hard to draw these scenes. You know, it's depressing to draw graveyard after graveyard. So I wanted to ask you, as you're drawing this, what gets you excited? Because ultimately, I find your books hilarious. Like, they're very funny. You may not see that in the scene, but they're super witty. But what gets you excited as you draw and you get through these topics?
Well, I don't know. Like, when I first write the story, I'm excited. Like, when I come up with a story that I want to tell, and I'm in the process of writing the script and thumbnailing it, like, I'm pretty high on, like, what a good idea I am having. By the time I get to drawing the final pages, I'm just, it's more of, I'm doing it because that is my work that I have decided that I will do. I get excited about, I love drawing people. Mm-hmm. I like drawing hands, especially. I like drawing people crying. I draw a lot of times you see in my comics kind of the same panel over and over with small changes to show just like minor moments that express what's going on inside. I'm really interested in, you know, when you say that the work is about bodies, I think what really attracts me to telling stories about bodies is the idea of abjection,
mm-hmm.
Kind of that you can have a lot of ideas about who you are and what you're doing in the world, and your body makes demands and expresses things that you don't always intend.
Mm-hmm.
And I said and, but I don't think I have a way to continue that thought.
So when I was referencing that I find your comics funny, what I think you take death and the life in these works very seriously, but what is really witty is the kind of anachronism in the speech you often give to the female characters. So both is Agnes, I was
Agnes
in this book, and the mermaids in Black is the Color. They use a mixture of historical and contemporary speech. So I wanted to ask you about that choice.
I mean, I think that my tendency is to write in a very formal way, like my prose writing. Mm-hmm. If you read like my column on the Comics Journal and stuff like that, it tends to be very stodgy in a way, like it's kind of more prim than I really find attractive. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't maybe want to read it, but that's just the way it comes out. And I think that my dialogue also has a tendency to be that way, and especially the thing that I always think about is The Once and Future King, you know that book?
No.
It's a retelling of Arthurian legend,
mm-hmm.
from the 30s. And some of the dialogue in it is taken from older sources, like mm-hmm. from Malory, and uses like a more old-fashioned dialect. And at one point, the writer says of Lancelot, he always fell into the grandeur of the high language when he was moved. So I think that sometimes when things get intense, then people tend to speak in a way that is austere or theatrical.
Mm-hmm.
Partly because I think that, you know, for example, in this book, there's a scene where the main characters have sex, and when they are beginning to become intimate with each other. They start to touch each other and express their desire to each other physically. They have this conversation of kind of quoting Julian of Norwich, saying, like one of them says, all will be well again, and the other one says, that's not true.
Mm-hmm.
Don't lie to me. Don't be strong for me. Nothing will ever be well. And I think that in those moments of emotional intensity, we come to sort of embody archetypes.
Mm-hmm.
We become, you know, the things that our bodies do connect us to the human chain of subjugation to the whims of our bodies that our ancestors have also.
Mm-hmm.
And it's part of a dialogue that's bigger than our individual experiences.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems appropriate to me to connect that to a self-expression that is also like more grandiose.
Mm-hmm. And then I think where it becomes witty is when, you know, the mermaid in the next panel will say, there's your boyfriend, he's the one on fire.
Oh yeah. I felt bad about that because people thought that the mermaids were being so cruel, and I guess they are, but this is my,
it's a different
not
book,
this book, my previous book, Black is the Color, which is about mermaids and stuff, where they are watching this ship sink that has been struck by lightning and is on fire. And they're kind of watching it like they're watching a movie, and they're like, oh, this is great. The mast is going to fall now, and the ship is going to break in half. But, I mean, how much can you really fault somebody who is not personally invested in a tragedy for, you know, not always empathizing?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think we all do that. I mean, you know, if I geek out about like the Manson murders and I'm not always like right there empathizing with Sharon Tate,
mm-hmm.
sometimes I'm just like fascinated by the cult, and that's like, that's very cruel.
So you're giving the mermaids that kind of independence that'll watch the ship burning.
Yeah, they're not involved. Like they don't right. care about those people. They don't know them.
I'm going to move on to talk about Natalie's work, but there's a million questions I could ask Julia about that this particular book. So Natalie is, this is a cover of Lemon and Kett, and Natalie sent me a lot of her micropress books. She's working on this larger adaptation of The Nutcracker, as I mentioned earlier, but she has these beautiful, and I don't know if you, do you have them with you, the little editions?
Yeah, I have some small ones.
Yeah, to show off, she has these beautiful micropress books, which many of the speakers' larger books also were originally issued as minis.
Just little.
So Natalie, I wanted to ask you, because we're talking again about representation of bodies and women in particular in comics. Your work to me appears to be influenced by video games and gaming. Can you talk about that?
I think that, right, in one of the comics I write that she doesn't want to swim anymore. The main character just wants to go home and play The Sims.
The Sims, yeah.
It was definitely a source of comfort for me when I was mm-hmm. a kid. And I think that while they're definitely, and I didn't play a whole lot of like console games.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't allowed to have anything that was fighting when I was a kid, or that had violence in it. So I played like The Sims and SimCity, and I'm not so sure how much it's how much my work is like influenced by characters from like video games mm-hmm. and stuff, but definitely the control and like that I had with those video games that were like simulation and like,
oh, that, like the Dollhouse game. So that's interesting.
Yeah,
that
Dollhouse,
wasn't where
yeah.
my question was leading, but I love that
yeah,
answer.
It's a different
that you think
kind of a...
The Sims and other Dollhouse are God games, which are the games where
right.
you get to control all aspects of the universe.
And
you draw on that
gardens.
Experience when you're making your comics?
Yeah, that I have full control over this thing, that I have control over producing it and the deadline for it and the
giving it to people. And where and how, and maybe that's how it's inspired by. And I still play video games like crazy, but I'll like something like the Harvest Moon kind of rip off Stardew Valley, which is very much like you're building in a really cute and positive world. And I think that kind of feeling is what I've realized I really wanted. I want to build in like a really positive and like fun and like fantastical world.
A lot of the characters in the comics you gave me are young girls going on adventures and often sort of beating larger, scarier looking characters, which I think is where I was going for. Like they're the girl characters beat the big boss, you know?
Yeah.
Can you talk about the deliberateness of that choice to make these younger, sort of adolescent-looking characters to be the heroes and save the day?
Yeah, also because of, like, so growing up, I really liked Indiana Jones, and I wanted, like, constantly, I was Indiana Jones. I was always Indiana Jones. But then, like, at recess or whatever, I would be put into whatever girl, a cute blonde girl that was the heroine. Like, why can't I be this? Why can't I be like a man, like this Indiana Jones? And then, I don't know, you also as like a young girl think you're invincible. Of course you can do the same things that Indiana Jones does. And of course you can do the same things as like, or, you know, crazier. There's nothing that you can, like that you can't do. And I think that these stories, I just want to, especially like the adventure one, Lemon and Ket, I just really wanted to show like the invincibility of a young woman and like her journey.
You did a large project, we don't have images of it, I don't think, that was retelling fables and fairy tales.
Oh, yeah.
What choices did you make in reinterpreting these classic archetypes, and how did that inform the work you're doing now?
Yeah, so my senior thesis, I graduated in 2013, was of a bunch of folk tales that, and so growing up in North Carolina, I heard like a lot of murder ballads and really like dark ghost stories and that were just told to us as like kids at camp. And so I wanted to come back to that and like draw those stories and like, just physically draw the folk tales. And all of them followed women and either they were, actually, there's one where a man stumbles into a swamp and he's introduced to a young woman who is a mermaid. But they're like all the women are kind of evil, but also very innocent seeming, which is what I like. Like I like this innocence, but that they know what they're doing at all times and like they are they're always in control of the situation. And but there's also like one woman is introduced to the devil in disguise and she has to decide between, she has to make like an impossible decision. And I think there, I just wanted to tell stories of women, maybe also in the South as like in a like a really negative world kind of for women. And I rewrote, I took stories from around the world that were my inspiration, some and like meshed them with stories that I had heard growing up to make them fresh, and so I didn't you know, butcher anyone's story that they heard as a kid, and referenced those and said, like, I got it from this, you know, culture, and this is how similar this culture is in this way to the South, the American South, and how like scary we all make folk tales, especially about women.
This is departing from that answer, which is fascinating. I love this picture with the movement on the page. What kind of reference materials do you use to, like, what do you look at to create this kind of figure?
So probably just from wanting to do this a lot, maybe, or definitely this whole book is inspired, or like it's about having a big sister and having a role model that I don't actually have. I don't have a big sister, and I've always wanted someone that can teach me how to be free and confident, and I'm so inspired by women that are confident when I can't. When I can't be this, I see them doing this in their writing or their on their Twitter, or you know, like being free and doing whatever you want.
So you're creating the person you want to have in your life, or that you want to be like or emulate on the page.
Yes.
That actually gets to a question I have for the group, which is, okay. Since we are talking about representation in comics, I want to ask, how much are you actively concerning yourself with representation when you think about the audience from your work and the choices you're making? And why don't we start back with Pénélope? And the question gets at, you know, like if you're thinking about the readers of your comics with Mama Cass, you know, how were you, you were actively, I mean, I think I know the answer to this, but please do answer it. You were actively concerned with making a positive representation of a fat woman.
I was more concerned of making people forget that she's a fat woman and just remembering that she's so cool. Because she's not here as a token. So I didn't want, you know, maybe I told you before, but that's one of the really weird reactions I had from the press in France, because people are more concerned about weight, I guess. Mm-hmm. And so that was almost the first question I always had. Like, so why did you choose to have a fat woman as a main character? That's so bold. And which was really probably the most stupid question I had. So I think we don't really care. It's based on a true person, and she was indeed fat. Mm-hmm. But there is not a moment in the book where she is the fat girl of the band, mm-hmm. no matter how the other band members are trying to label her this, but if it works when you finish the book, it's not the story of a fat woman. It's mm-hmm. a story of a very strong and determined and very, very cool and funny woman. So I just didn't want this to be a topic. It was like, okay, page 7, she's fat. Next. And so there are people along her path and in my story that really want her to remember that she's fat. Mm-hmm. You know, there were contracts that she missed because labels had a clause where they said that she could only get contracts if she lost weight. And so, of course, she told them to, you know. So she said, no,
great.
Why would I do that? That's ridiculous. And she could see that some of her friends totally backed her on this and said, of course not, you're not going to lose weight. And some others were like, well, you know, it would be better for you anyway. And so, but to her, it's preposterous every time somebody brings up the subject. And that's also what I wanted the reader to feel. After a few pages, like, oh, please, come on, okay, we get it, she's fat. And then it kind of blends in and you forget that part. So, you know, it's like trying to have female characters in some mm-hmm. way. At some point, you just want your reader to forget she's a woman and just focus on, okay, is she brave? Is she cool? Is she mean? Is she, we don't care if she's a woman. You know, there's this neutral male, did you say that?
Mm-hmm.
That I think more and more writers are trying to...
The everyman.
Yeah, you know, okay, it doesn't... The neutral default character doesn't have to be a man. Well, maybe she doesn't even have to be slim either or white. And then at some point we will not care anymore that she's fat.
Right. I mean, I think we're saying the same thing, though, because my point is that to represent a body that is not our normative idea of what is a neutral character is still a powerful choice, and to represent it in such a positive way is...
Well, to be totally honest, it's also a selfish thing because it's mm-hmm. so much better to draw. You know, she's so beautiful. It was such a... I had such a great time drawing her dancing, you know, doing a lot of things. It's a pleasure of drawing too, and I really do think that's something you can communicate to people who are watching your drawings. You can tell that I wasn't having a hard time doing this, and I really loved her. Mm-hmm. So maybe that's a good way of doing so.
To draw what you love to see.
Yeah, and what you love to draw.
Julia, do you want to talk about representation in your work? One thing that comes to mind is that you draw, in both of the books I've read, this frank sexuality of women that is often not represented or traditionally not represented.
I think my stories come from, because I'm really interested in, I read a lot of historical texts, I'm interested in mythology, and kind of motifs that reappear throughout the history of literature. And for a lot of reasons, those stories are normally communicated from a male perspective, mm-hmm. in a way that treats women as very alien. And what interests me is thinking about what are the women doing in those stories? Why would they be doing those things? Mm-hmm. So like in Black is the Color, which has kind of one of the plots in it is about these mermaids who are observing sailors from a distance. You know, normally when you hear or mythology to do with mermaids talks about, you know, they're very beautiful, they're singing, they're trying to make sailors crash on the rocks, they want to make out with the sailors, and then they want to drown them. Like, in my story, I was thinking about how, like, why are these women doing these things? And, you know, I've had, probably every woman here has had the experience of, like, you are doing something for yourself, or you, like, you're wearing a dress because you like the dress or whatever, mm-hmm. and some dude is like, oh, you did that because you're trying to make me, you know, you wore those shoes because you knew that would give me a boner, and now the boner is your responsibility. So I felt like, you know, what if these mermaids are doing these things just because they like to do them, and the men who are responding to it are the ones that are ascribing this manipulative...
Siren call.
Yeah.
Right. Anyone else want to pick up? I'd love to hear from others, since given the topic of the panel, like, how deliberately do you think about representation? It's a very current topic, and I recognize that, and in some ways don't want this panel to be about representation, again, like a tokenism, which I think is a very important critique to bring up about the question and the movement. But at the same time, we are in such an era of considering these ideas that I think every artist is grappling with it as they approach their books. Katie, what about you?
I tend to think about things from my character's point of view, mm-hmm. I think. And I tend to think a lot about the male gaze, and I try to write women who are aware that they're under the male gaze. Mm-hmm. So that's why, you know, even though it might seem campy and kitschy and fun, that's why a lot of times I do put them in outfits that are sort of revealing, because I want to be able to tell a story from their perspective, and I also want you to feel their vulnerability in that sort of costuming, which mm-hmm. you would see in, you know, in superhero comics and genre comics, the 60s, 70s comics that I really love. So trying to sort of take that back and sort of show, like, you know, here's what it means to be a nurse in outer space in a skimpy outfit, or here's what it means to be a teenage vampire that's, you know, lusted after by your brother, and all that sort of, like, campy, kitschy stuff. But I want to put it in a way that's uncomfortable. I do think that it can be sexy, and a lot of times I do try to make it sexy at the same time. But also, I think with with my characters, for the longest time, I was drawing these idealized bodies because for the longest time, I didn't feel great about myself. Mm-hmm. And I thought, you know, at least if I can draw these characters looking this particular way, it's like I can live vicariously mm-hmm. through them. And now that fortunately has changed. And now, you know, I'm a lot more willing to have them go through things that are terrible. I'm more willing to have them, you know, get shot at in comics and have to get amputated mm-hmm. or get bitten or bite other people or, you know, have blood all over them. I don't feel that sort of need to make them super idealized anymore. But that is something that I'm really interested in exploring. You know, what happens when this sort of perfect-looking woman, what happens when she's internalizing the male gaze and sort of throwing that back on the world?
That's interesting to me, just to pick up on that. Do you think of the first two books as an artifact in some ways of that time for you?
I think so. I think Nurse Nurse definitely was, because that was a book that I started right after I graduated college, and I worked on it for like 5 years. Like mm-hmm. I worked on it for a really long time. And, you know, I liked that book a lot, and to date, it's the longest thing I've ever done. It's 160 pages, and the two after that were, you know, like 110, 120. But yeah, I think that was definitely an artifact of that. I think Operation Margin was a lot of working through that. Mm-hmm. I wrote a character for that book that is anorexic and is processing it, but is never something specifically that I named in that comic. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to be very deliberate about that. And I also wanted to make sure that she was a fully fledged character. I didn't want her eating disorder to just be like an after school special where this character is going through something. Because, you know, I've gone through it. I know many women that have gone through it. And you still have a life, even if you're processing all of this baggage that you have about your body. You're still going to work, you're still in relationships, you're still functioning. So I really wanted to tell a story about a character like that. And then I think with, you know, doing the work that I did for Sluttist and doing, you know, the more erotic stuff and then getting into vampire and stuff like that, I do think that I've sort of processed all of that. And, you know, now I just want to take revenge on everybody and kill them. So yeah, that's where I'm at.
Right on.
Whit, do you want to pick this up? How actively are you thinking about representation, maybe in the work going forwards also, because I know you're working on a new project.
Mm-hmm. Sure. So I guess I'll split it into two things. So the first thing, like in terms of autobio, I think that if you're drawing yourself, you have to be willing to make yourself look unattractive, like not just as like physically, but just in terms of like your personality, how you're going to be from moment to moment, because nobody has it all together at all times. And I often get the most like, I feel the most distance from stories where people present themselves as perfect, because that's just not how most of us live on a, you know, a day-to-day basis. I will say about the, you know, going back to the race stuff. So since I've started in comics, I have seen a major push towards diversity in comics, which I think is a great thing. But at the same time, I don't always know what diversity means. And sometimes I feel like it's done on a very surface level. It's like, we just put a person with a darker skin tone in this comic, but we haven't given them any personality. Mm-hmm. There's no backstory. There's no history. There's nothing specific to the culture or area where they came from. And like, I can't get behind that. I can get behind developing characters, whether it's your own personal characters in your life or it's some character that you're creating, and like really developing that character. But I don't feel like, you know, having physical bodies that are different colors or different features, that's a stand-in for actual like diversity. So that's just something I'm always trying to like be mindful of when I'm, you know, creating work. Even with the nib stuff, I do try to switch it up. If I'm drawing, like, let's say I'm drawing a specific story about a racial issue, I try to make people look different depending on, you know, if the image is from a specific time in the 1950s, then I'll try to make it look, you know, in keeping with that time period. So I'm aware of those things, but I just think that it's a greater issue than just like physically drawing someone a certain way. And
it's like the 1980s sitcom where there'd be like this guy pops up, yeah. You know, and they have nothing differentiating them other than the color of their skin that they cast the actor as.
Yeah. And like I said, I think that things are moving in good direction, but there's still always, you know, more work that needs to be done. And what were you saying about the project?
Oh, just because I know you're working on a larger project for Fulcrum. Is that correct? That's mm-hmm. on health education. So that is going to be marketed to a broad audience. And so I wanted to ask how you're considering representation as you approach it.
Sure. So that project is on public health history and like why we have the certain at least for now, institutions that we currently have, and how they you know, developed that way. So I've been doing a lot of research just on, like, you know, 18th, 19th century stuff. I don't know, trying to just get as many archival images as I can from different time periods. So there's things that take place in, like, the 70s, there's things that take place in the 1890s, and also keeping, you know, dialect in mind. And
so that's more about accuracy. So thinking about being accurate and presenting what can, in other instances, maybe have been erased in prior work. Natalie, what about you? You spoke earlier about coming from the South and it being important to you to show strong women in the South. Are there other things you consider in representation in your work?
Yeah, thinking about the South and, like, growing up, I really didn't have many books or children's books that had women as main characters, and I was like reading Harry Potter, like, this should be a girl. Mm-hmm. Why isn't Harry a girl? Why did J.K. Rowling not make Harry a girl? Anyway, I thought that a lot. Growing up, and I guess I want to make stories that are like my, as a kid, they're like Natalie approved when I was 7. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, mm-hmm. I would pick this up, and oh my gosh, I want to read something that's, adventure story with a girl, or just like, a funky story that's not about being a girl, just living a life and, like, with some girl stuff, like, some, like, wearing a one piece instead of, I don't know.
But small choices to you mean representation is diversified. So making choices that are perhaps even as slight as that kind of bathing suit a character wears is a choice that's going to represent someone who maybe hasn't seen that.
Yeah, also about, like, so I draw mostly kids, young women, mm-hmm. And so I'm, like, very conscious of, like, if, like, I drew a swim team story, like, no aspect of that do I want to be sexual, because that's not something I would have been like, that's weird, as a kid, I don't care about this, which is fine, it's just not what I'm looking to do, mm-hmm. And so in a swim team comic, like, oh, if she's going to be bending down, I'm so hyper aware of, like, I really have to make sure that this isn't something that subconsciously someone's going to think, oh, there, that's a butt. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, how cute is that butt that they drew?
Like, I was trying to click through your comics because I think that actually gets at the way in your work the bodies are about the actions they take. Because there's a lot of activity in the books.
There's a lot of awkwardness and noodly arms and dealing with your body
that feels familiar.
Yeah. Doesn't do what you want it to do.
I think we have to wrap up soon. I want to ask everyone to call out somebody you're reading now that you love, who you could have seen on this panel. Is there an author, artist? And if you feel on the spot, that's fine. You can also talk about someone that inspired you in your work. But who
Can
are
I
you
not
reading?
Go first?
Yeah, okay, no, you don't have to. Natalie, back at you.
Okay. okay. So I just finished reading. So also, like, Piao works with a lot of artists that I really admire as well. And one, her name is Mathilde Kitty. Mm-hmm. Kitty. And she and Luca, she and a boy, Luca Oliver. They made a book together called Wrecked Hearts, mm-hmm. and it's a really nice book. And Mathilde is currently in France, but it would have been nice to see her talk about the story that's very emotional and beautiful and drawn. And like a young, like, very cute girl is extremely powerful and has a like a beautiful story to tell, and she's great.
Whit, who are you reading that you love?
I mean, I'm kind of blanking on who I'm currently reading, but like a big influence. I think Gabrielle Bell is one of my favorite autobio mm-hmm. cartoonists. I just think she's like flawless at it. Like very honest and just very good at picking out what are the things that that the reader needs to know. What are the things that like she really focuses on making it a story, and it's very open. And totally opposite end of the spectrum in terms of like comics journalism. I really like Mari Nako. He's a comics journalist who does stuff for Popular Science and also The Nib, and he's been doing a lot of really great stuff on just like basic human biology, health stuff lately that I'm really impressed with.
My turn. I just finished reading a short comic called Lovers in the Garden by Anya Davidson. And I write for the comics journal. I write reviews for them. So I'm going to try to write a review of that very soon. But it's just like a very short genre work. It's like a 70s sort of like crime exploitation comic, and it's really good. She's really, really good. And there's not, it feels very cheap to say there's not a lot of women working in genre, because I know that's not true, but that's also, there's not a lot of like cartoonists working mm-hmm. in genre, like on the independent mm-hmm. side. So to see something like that is really amazing. And she's also very versatile. She can do psychedelic, she can do sort of more like abstract comics. I like to see someone who's very versatile like that.
Is that Fantagraphics?
That, she just did a book with Fanta called Banned for Life. Mm-hmm. This one is from Retrofit. They're like a small like mm-hmm. indie publisher. They sent me like, I was like, oh, I'm looking for this book to review, and they literally sent me their entire catalog. So I have about 40 books that I'm going through right now, but that's definitely on the top of the pile.
I'm gonna shout out my friend Celine Loop, who does, she's a great illustrator and also has done some really great comics. That her style is very beautiful and seductive, like almost like a Yoshitaka Amano kind of Art Nouveau dreaminess to it. But the stories are just brutal. Like they're really dark and harsh and very much about like the terrifying aspects of being a woman mm-hmm. and an object of predation. Mm-hmm. So you should all check out her work. She's also did some work for the anthology that my boyfriend and I curated that's coming out soon.
The Mirror Mirror?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Of course, I can't remember anything that influenced me this instant. But there's this book I'm reading right now. It's called The Best We Could Do by mm-hmm. Tibui. Did you see that?
Yes, it's fantastic. And
but I haven't finished it, so don't spoil.
We're excerpting it on my website.
it's really great. So it's a story that is told by a woman at the beginning of the book. She's 30 and she just had her first baby, and everything is a nightmare about this. Mm-hmm. But also she's Vietnamese born. She was born in Saigon, and her parents fled from Vietnam when she was, I think, 4, with this huge family. She has like a ton of brothers and sisters. And so she has this baby, and it kind of screws up all her relationships with her own parents, because she discovers the pure joy of giving and giving to people who don't care about you, kids. And and also she starts to understand why she always had these odd relationships with her own parents, because they never fit in America. And they always felt like they still belonged in Vietnam, and she never did, because she doesn't really have memories of that. So maybe the end sucks, because I'm right in the middle, but it really is a page turner so far, and it's really great. And it's her first book.
It's an incredible book. If you're interested in it, we're running an excerpt on MUTHA Magazine, which is the feminist parenting site that I run. And there was also a piece in the same issue of Penn Illustrated that Whitney is in, State of Emergency, Artists Respond to the New President.
And if you mention representation of women, mm-hmm. I talked with her because we were at the Comic-Con in Seattle mm-hmm. last week. And she raised a challenge that seemed even bigger than drawing yourself. It's drawing your mother, because she says that her mom is still alive.
Which Gabrielle Bell does as well, actually.
Yeah, in her new book. Mm-hmm.
What's the name of the book again? One more time.
Tibui. It's The Best We Could Do.
The Best We Could Do.
And Gabrielle's book is Everything is Flammable. The books I've read most recently are everyone on this panel's in preparation, which leads me to any questions from the audience, because after that we're going to have these artists convene to sign the books that you will be buying. Who would like to ask a question? I have many more if no one raises their hand. Great, let me pack this. Can I pass the mic around, Peter? Is it cool to pass the mic?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Over
there? Yeah.
Perfect.
Hi, I guess I'll sit
Stan, I don't know. I have a question for Whit. I'm really intrigued by your healthcare thing. It seems like it's supposed to be like kind of a public service, and I just have a question about that. I worked in healthcare, so like I have seen like how people just kind of have no idea like what they're paying for and like what they need to do for like the most basic things in their life, which kind of seems like a, you know, deliberate thing that the healthcare industry kind of like wants to leave people in the dark. And I guess I was just sort of wondering like what categories you were looking to go into, and like I was wondering like, are you going to talk about like insurance, or like what is your general goal of where you want to go with this project?
Sure. So it's more of a history book. So it's not really talking about things as they currently are, but it's more of like looking back at how they ended up this way, and not as much on like health insurance, but the institutions such as the CDC or the FDA or things like that, and how we got to the point where we needed those things. So, yeah.
Hi. I just wanted to ask all of you what media you use to attain the images that you create, and how you ended up using those media to make them.
I work digitally, and then I risograph my work because it's accessible, and I am completely in control of the medium and it's something that I'm able to learn. It's a skill that I'm in control of, and that's why I gravitated towards it, and digital is just much easier for me, even though I want to work traditionally again. Seeing the Penelope's pencils, I used to do all pencil work, and it seemed like you did digital for a while and then you went to pencil.
And then I went back to digital. Yeah. It was just a one-time thing.
That's really great to hear. And I think that I want to do it too. But it's so much work. I have to be really, strong, get through it in time, meet my deadlines.
I'm sorry. Can you restate the question you were asking about like medium, or like, I mean, what we're currently using?
Yeah, how do you draw?
Okay.
What do you
use? Sorry. Thank you. So I dabble in digital, but I, to be honest, it's not really my thing. I would like it to be my thing one day. I feel like it would be a lot quicker, for instance, for web work. But I mostly use markers. I like drawing with markers. It's nothing really complicated about it. I don't know, this is what I use, and it's fun.
You color with markers too, right? Wait, when you do the colors, do you line by line? You can see.
I do. I used to use like thinner pens, and I was doing a lot of cross hatching and stuff, and it was just looking kind of muddy and busy. And so I had a friend who suggested that I try to switch up my line and like try to experiment with some different stuff, and I did. And after that, I felt like it was a bigger jump for me. So I've just been continuing with that.
I do pen and ink just on Bristol board, and I color digitally. And I do that for a couple of reasons. One is that I'm a dummy, and I don't know how to use a tablet. I've tried many times, and the line just goes the complete opposite way. I don't know how it works, and I'll never learn. And the other reason is because I like to sell the pages. So yeah, that's my very intelligent answer.
Grandma number two also uses traditional media. I used a rapidograph pen, the 0.35 millimeter one, size zero, and I settled on that because it photocopies well, and I like to make minis. I don't do anything on the computer because I hate working on the computer. It's frustrating, it's slow. What you see printed in the book is what's drawn on the page. I touch up with white ink sometimes. And for my minis, I lay them out and paste them up with a Xerox machine. So no InDesign or anything. Old school.
And I do everything on a computer because I studied animation. So I was working on Flash that everyone used back then, because it was a long time ago. And then I started working in advertising, so everything had to be done for in 2 hours. So it seemed, you know, and then you kind of, you start to have habits. Because when you work quickly with something and it works, you don't really take that time to experiment, which I totally regret. But every time I start a new book, I think, this is it. I'm going to do pastel or oil. And of course, I do Photoshop in the end. Oh, but no, it's kind of my tool. And I really know how to have subtleties with it. And it's not that basic when you know how to use it, I guess.
But with cast, because we talked about this, you did it in pencil and you didn't erase. Is that correct?
Yeah, I did.
I haven't seen this talked about in any of the reviews so far.
The fact that I didn't use an eraser?
Yes.
I used to give drawing lessons to little kids, mm-hmm. and I was confiscating erasers the first day, because otherwise you draw with it in your hand, always willing to. It's like your control Z on your left hand. So no. So if you confiscate,
did you hit that? Them?
Yes, because we use corporal punishment in France. It's still okay. So yes, no. But if you know that you can do that, everything you will draw will be super controlled. If you think, if I screw it up, I screw it up. Then I think it kind of shows that it's more spontaneous. So the worst that can happen is that the line is not perfect. So
and it looks cool at that point. It looks handmade and
also when you original. Like a page like this, if I make a mistake at the end of the page, I have two options. Either I can start the whole page all over again, which I will not do because it has taken me too long, or you know, so that's a good way of when you have, you know, 300 pages to make. No. You're less picky, I guess.
I think we had one more question, then we probably have to wrap up. Is that right, Pete? Yeah, thank you. Sorry, we went a few minutes late.
Mine's a quick question. Penelope, do you still like the song California Dreamin'?
Mm-hmm. No. It's like homework. Yes, the book came out a year and a half ago in France, and everywhere I've been promoting it. And it was a nice gesture, but people always said, and we have a song that I think you're going to like. And I'm like, oh, that's California Dreamin'. And no, I can't. I still love the Mamas and the Papas very much. But this very song, and you know, the other day I was at the supermarket with my boyfriend. And after like one and a half of a note, I said, oh, that's California Dreamin'. And he said, oh, yeah. And I said, oh, you know, I just need to hear like a microsecond of it. And I know, and I hear everything in it now. So... No, maybe in a few years.
Thank you all. And all of the artists will be sitting to sign their books. If you have more questions, come with them and a copy to get signed. Thank you, everyone. And I have to say, being at the Strand was so meaningful to me. I love this bookstore. Thank you so much for coming out in the cold.
Thank you.